I got a Coke button in my mouth. All right, Job chapter 28. Uh-oh. Job chapter 28. Well, that was an eye-opener for me one day. I do love the book of Job. And you read the conversation those four men have. And you go find me four people in Fairmont got the wisdom of those men.
So me, Bill, Warren.
Yeah, I called
Bill. I'm definitely in that group somewhere.
And you, okay.
I'm the one that speaks last there. The fifth one that shows up. What's his name? Elihu.
I'm the first one to make four of myself.
First thing I say, look at you and Bill, and I said, I thought that age should have spoken wisdom, but old men are not always wise, you know. the eye-opener for me, though, about the book of Job is that these men had a great understanding of righteousness, justice, judgment, equality, equity, all these things. And God shows up in the later end of the book and said, "Who is this that darkeneth counsel by words without knowledge?" Yeah. So God observed the whole conversation and said, "There ain't none of you know what you're talking about." That baffles me. This man's wisdom, the wisdom of Christ and God's wisdom, the wisdom of our God, is so much superior to ours. He compares it as high as heaven is above the earth. So are my ways and my thoughts higher than yours. God doesn't think like we think. He doesn't understand the way we understand. He's superior to us. And here in Job chapter 28, remember last week, we talked about wisdom being the principal thing. And now here in Job 28 verse 1, it says, "Surely there is a vein for the silver, and a place for gold where they find it. Iron is taken out of the earth, and brass is molten out of the stone. He setteth an end to darkness, searcheth out all perfection, the stones of darkness and the shadow of death. The flood breaketh out from the inhabitant, even the waters forgotten of the foot. They are dried up, they are gone away from men. As for the earth, out of it cometh bread, and under it is turned up as it were fire. The stones of it are the place of sapphires, and it hath dust of gold. There is a path which no fowl knoweth, and which the vulture's eye hath not seen. The lion's whelps have not trodden it, nor the fierce lion passed by it. He putteth forth his hand upon the rock, he overturneth the mountains by the roots, he cutteth out rivers among the rocks, and his eye seeth every precious thing. He bindeth the floods from overflowing, and the thing that is hid bringeth he forth to the light. But where shall wisdom be found? And where is the place of understanding?" Amen. Realize what they're saying here? You can go out here and you can dig down in the earth. You can find gold, silver, iron. You got all this stuff going on in the earth. But he says there's a path. And this thing that not even the fowl of the air, who have flew above the heavens and seen everything going on under the earth, there's something that they've not been able to find also. And what the question is here is, where shall wisdom be found? Now, if you remember, last week, we looked at Proverbs 4:7, in which Solomon said, wisdom is the principal thing. Now, that word principal means the most important, folks. It means chief, right? There's something God ordained before the world unto our glory. It's called wisdom. We read Proverbs chapter 8, "Before ever the earth was, wisdom said, I was brought forth." Amen? Wisdom is the most important thing in heaven and earth. I believe it. And because of that, Solomon says, therefore, here's the conclusion. If it's the principal thing, what should you get? Wisdom. Amen. If you die naked as a wise man, you die better than a fool with all the riches of this world. Yeah. Remember that man that had that great harvest that year and said, now, he said, put it up in my barns. I'm going to eat and drink and be merry. What did Christ call that man? Thou fool. That's what he called him. He called him a fool. He said, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. And then whose things will those be? Amen. Solomon called that out in Ecclesiastes. He said, I've seen a great evil. A man labors and acquires great riches, and then they go to another man. Another man enjoys them. He said, this is vanity and vexation of the spirit. If a man dies ignorant and as a fool, he dies as poor as he could ever get. Wisdom is the principal thing. And because of this, listen, you've got a book, man. Socrates and everybody have sought it out, haven't they? The Greeks seek after wisdom, right? Wisdom is the principal thing. Paul said, we preach Christ to the Greeks foolishness. But unto us that are saved, Christ both the power and wisdom of God. But you see, Socrates and all these men, they couldn't find it. It is the principal thing. But where's the place of it? If wisdom is the principal thing, Solomon's conclusion then is therefore get wisdom. Get it. And with all thy getting, get understanding. Amen. That used to be my voicemail on my phone. When my voicemail pick up, I would quote that verse, wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom with all thy getting, get understanding. That hammered me in my mid-20s, Gary. 25, 26 years old, I read it. I said, if it's the principal thing, then it's the most important. Therefore, I want it. Amen? And so this stuff's important. Now, let me ask you this. If wisdom is the principal thing, then the question here in Job, where shall wisdom be found? Must be, that should be the number one question in all of our lives then, shouldn't it? If wisdom is the principal thing, and the question is, where shall wisdom be found, finding the answer to that question ought to be the most important thing in your life. Yeah. Yeah. Amen? Keep reading down there in Job. Look at verse 13. Man knoweth not the price thereof. Neither is it found in the land of the living. Good luck. Okay. Man don't know the value of it. What price would you put on the principal thing? I know what man pays for gold. I know what they pay for coal. I know what they'll pay for oil. But what price are you... what price are you going to put on wisdom? Solomon said it's above rubies. He said in Proverbs chapter 8, he said, of all things that may be desired, nothing can compare to it. What price would you put on wisdom? You know what makes gold so valuable? How rare it is. Well, if you can't find wisdom in the land of the living, what price are you going to put on it? It must be valuable. Amen? But man don't know the price. I said here last week, I know man don't know the price because Judas sold Jesus Christ for 30 pieces of silver. You think he understood the value of that man? He was incarnate wisdom. Paul's walking around in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. He said, we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery. And in chapter 4, he said, under this present hour, we both hunger and thirst, are naked, having no certain dwelling place. You think the world values wisdom? Paul speaking the hidden wisdom of God, and he couldn't even get a pair of tennis shoes out of the deal. And then you got men like Kanye West and Jay-Z and LeBron James and men like that worth billions of dollars. And they got some of the money from some of you. You got Jay-Z albums at the house, Gary. You ain't gonna kid me. I mean, we could throw the country stars there. It don't matter. The point I'm making is these men are worth all this money. And then the men who have the most valuable thing, the principal thing in heaven and earth, don't have nothing. But truly they have it all. Amen? Look in Proverbs chapter 2. Wisdom. You want to find it? You get down there at the end of Job 28, you don't have to flip back here, but you get there to the end of Job 28, and God said when he made the heaven and the earth, he sought it out. He said, I seen it. He said, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom, and to depart evil is understanding. Yeah. And listen, man, evil ain't just sitting at the bar getting drunk. Some of the most desperate evil in this world is religious evil. Amen? Ministers of Satan who transform themselves into the ministers of righteousness. You know a man has acquired understanding when he departs evil. Amen? And the fear of the Lord is that when you fear God, not just any old church is going to do. When you fear God, you'll depart evil. Proverbs chapter 2. Look at all these conditions. Verse 1. See all them ifs? Verse 3, if. Solomon says, my son, if thou wilt receive my words and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom and apply thine heart to understanding. This is what you're going to have to understand about wisdom. The way you get wisdom is you have to saturate yourself in truth. You just got to saturate yourself in it. You ain't always going to understand it. But your heart, what did Solomon say there? He said, receive my words and hide them with you so that you will incline your ear unto wisdom. Now notice the next part, apply. You have to apply your heart to understand it. And only you know, man, you know where your heart is during the day. Amen. When I finally lay down to go to sleep, I sit and toss and turn. I have to sleep on the couch a lot of the times to turn the television on just to occupy my mind. Because when I lay down in a quiet room, Gary, my heart's just going through scripture. What did he mean here? And what does this mean? And what is that? Application, you know, we always talk about application. My main objective in this church is to teach doctrine. The application is up to you. Amen? Paul gives you doctrine, says walk worthy. He might give you some guidelines, but it's up to us to apply it. We can sit and put truth after truth after truth into your mind and into your heart, and if you won't apply your own heart to understand it, it's all in vain anyway. But he says, if you'll do this, hide my words, receive them, incline your ear to wisdom, apply thine heart to understand. Yea, if thou criest after knowledge, liftest up thy voice for understanding. I can't tell you the amount of times, man, that I've sat with tears dropping on the pages of, not this Bible, but some of my old Bibles. You know why I was crying? I was ignorant. And I was scared of the fact that I was ignorant. Listen, Solomon talks about the words of the wise and their dark sayings. Gary, I would read Paul, I would read Solomon, I would read David. They were so far over me, I couldn't tell what was going on. You know what it did? It scared me. The greatest fear in my life became my ignorance. And that's when I began to go to these pages and say, God, teach me. Show me the truth, Lord. I couldn't eat. There's been time, there was a 6-month period one time where I lost like 25 pounds. My wife will tell you. I remember looking in the shower and seeing my ribs and looking up at God and saying, God, do you not care? Understanding that book become the most important thing in my life. And Solomon said, if you'll cry after knowledge, searchest for her as for hid treasures. Look at verse 5. Then, there's conditions. He says, then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. Those things, You say that's Old Testament. You want the New Testament counterpart? If you be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above, not on the things of the earth. For ye are dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. Once again, good luck. Still ain't found in the land of the living, is it? How you gonna seek a bunch of things seated at the right hand of God? Things that eye can't see and ear cannot hear. Look at Proverbs chapter 8. Ruckman used to quote Proverbs 8:9 all the time for all them King James critics. You know, you can't understand the King James Bible. Wisdom says that all her words are plain to him that understandeth, and right to them that find knowledge. What is understanding? It's to depart evil. Isn't that what Job concluded? To depart evil is understanding. Ruckman said the problem ain't education, it ain't textual criticism, the problem's understanding. He said God didn't say you wasn't educated. He said you didn't understand. And what is understanding? It's to depart evil. The moment you depart evil is the moment that this book will become plain to you. Amen? But you're going to have to get it out of your head that evil is everything you think it is. Pentecostalism is evil, folks. Let's just call it what it is. Apostolic doctrine and Pentecostalism and the Church of God of Prophecy, Seventh-day Adventism, that stuff is evil. It is iniquity. And to depart iniquity, let every man that nameth the name of Christ depart iniquity. When you will depart, and let me throw the Baptist in there with all of them. I'll sum the Baptist up. I remember when I seen this flag really paid attention to it for the first time. They got that big flag, you know. Says this right here, Baptist. Then over here it says the blood, the book, and the blessed hope. There's nothing wrong with this. There's nothing wrong with that, Gary. It's true. But look how they emphasize that. The top of the flag is Baptist. You'll find out being a Baptist is more important than any of those three things right there. They put being a Baptist above the Word of God all the time. So we'll just throw them right in there with it. You see, there came a point in my time where I became more scared of being ignorant of that book than I was of not being a Baptist. Look at Proverbs 8:10. Receive my instruction and not silver, and knowledge rather than choice gold. For wisdom is better than rubies, and all the things that may be desired are not to be compared to it. I love that verse. I love it. We could take all the possessions of all of us. Amen? We could take everything every one of us has, lay it in a big pile, and that pile is not to be compared with wisdom. Amen? Now listen, if that's not your reality, that you esteem instruction, you know how the book of Proverbs began? You know what separates a wise man from a fool? It's not his education. What separates a wise man from a fool is not how much knowledge he has in this worthless knowledge stuff. What separates a wise man from the fool is Proverbs 1:7. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. What separates the wise from the fool is what they're looking for. Amen. What's he saying there? Receive instruction and not silver. The wise man's looking for instruction, the fool's seeking silver. But you know what Solomon said in Ecclesiastes? He that loveth silver shall not be satisfied with silver. You think Solomon didn't know? I promise you he did. He said, if a man loves silver, he will not be satisfied with silver, nor he that loveth increase with abundance. Go ask George Soros and Bill Gates if they're satisfied. Bill Gates is worth over $50 billion. And I wouldn't exchange what I have in my mind from that book for all the money of Bill Gates. I wouldn't do it. Wouldn't give it up. We receive instruction and not silver, and wisdom and knowledge rather than choice gold. For wisdom is better than rubies, and all things that are to be desired are not to be compared with it. You see, if you're not seeking instruction and knowledge and wisdom and understanding, it's because you don't know the price of wisdom. You don't know its value and what it'll gain you in eternity. When Paul said, lay hold on eternal life, this gets to the heart of it. You lay hold on eternal life by laying hold on this book. That's how you lay hold on it. Paul tells the rich man, he says, you tell the rich not to trust in their riches. Amen? But tell them to fight the good fight and to lay hold on eternal life and lay up unto themselves a good foundation against that day. What does he tell them to lay hold on? Eternal life. Amen? Everything we work for down here is not going with us. When we talk about wood, hay, and stubble, gold, silver, and precious stones, we're talking about wisdom and folly. This is what we're talking about. You want to be rich in the life to come, there's only one thing. It is the principal thing of heaven and earth. It's wisdom. And man don't know the value of it, nor do men understand the poverty of ignorance. They don't understand the true poverty of ignorance. Look at Colossians chapter 2. When we talk about knowledge, man, we're not talking about 2 plus 2 equals 4. And, you know, E equals MC squared and gravitational constants and all that other nonsense. We're not talking about knowledge like the world talks about knowledge. You see, people don't value knowledge because they don't understand the value of it, what it truly is. If I replace the word knowledge with Christ, does that add something to it? If I replace wisdom with Jesus Christ, does that add something to it? If I told you that if you get these things, that what you're getting is the mind of the Lord Jesus Christ, that God is allowing you through this wisdom and knowledge to share in the mind of His Son, does that help you see the value of it? And not having that mind, do you now understand the poverty, the true result of being ignorant? Look at Colossians 2, verse 8. We're talking about riches and poverty, ain't we? Beware lest any man spoil you. Of what, Paul? Look back in verse 3. All the treasures of what? Look there in verse 7, verse 27 of chapter 1. To whom God would make known what is the what? The riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is who in you? The hope of what? There it is. Your hope is in direct proportion to how much of Christ is in you when you stand before God. Christ in you is the hope of glory. Now, I thank God we're all in Christ and we're all going to heaven when we die. But what Paul's talking about in Colossians chapter 1 is presenting you to the Father. Look what he says in verse 28. Whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all what? That we may what? Present every man perfect in Christ. How are you going to be presented perfect in Christ? Through the wisdom and knowledge of the Son of God. It ain't going to matter how many people you fed while you were down here. That's self-righteous. That's people being self-righteous. You know, you're going to stand before God one day and he's going to go over your whole life and be like, well, you did that, 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 and that. You're just as dumb as a box of rocks. You never read my Bible, but you did all that stuff. Therefore, I'm going to let you reign over here and give you all this. And then you got a man that spent day after day like Bollinger. And men like that spent their life in that book. And when you heard these men talk, you just, their breath just reeked of the wisdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. But they spent most of their life hidden behind doors in a book. And you think men like that's going to be shoved over in the corner because they didn't feed the homeless? Christ said, labor not for the meat that perisheth. Fed 5,000 one time. He said, I know why you followed me. You followed me because your bellies were filled. Amen, amen, amen. You get them into church with bean dinners and banquets and all this other stuff and music, you'll lose them just as soon as that stuff stops, folks. But you'll only... What's Paul being taught? What is he talking about being spoiled of? He's talking about being spoiled of the Lord Jesus Christ. Was that not the prize in Philippians? That I may win Christ? I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. How are you going to get it, Paul? By suffering the loss of everything for the excellency of the knowledge of Jesus Christ, my Lord. Knowledge. And he said, I've done it that I may win him. Amen. And then he comes over here and he's talking about Christ in you, the hope of glory, and says, don't let any man spoil you. People are trying to, listen, religion and all that stuff is trying to rob you of Christ in you. Isn't that God's plan? Isn't that how God is bringing down the current world system? Didn't God choose the foolish things of the world to confound the things that are wise? Amen. What do you think Satan wants? Satan's scared to death of that man, Gary. The greatest fear Satan has in this world is you people learning who you are in Christ and then accessing all of those blessings in heavenly places and all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge, because when Christ fills you, that bum can't dwell anywhere. Darkness cannot be where there's light. And the more Christ you get in you, the less he has access. We talked about it this morning that it's ignorance that alienates us from God, the life of God. That's the poverty of ignorance. You can have all the toys, four-wheelers and all this stuff, man, boats, bass boats and... You know, I worked with men in the coal mines. I had a boy look at me one time. He was an atheist. He looked at me and he said, he was 20-some years old, had boats and four-wheelers and all this stuff. And he said, I've made it this long without God. He said, I think I'm doing pretty good. I said, tell me how well you die without him. Yeah. He got quiet then. The reality is, man, you can have all that stuff. The true poverty of ignorance is you're alienated from the life of God. That's poverty. You don't have nothing if you don't have the life of the Creator. Amen? You'll only find wisdom when you seek it. You'll only seek it when you see its value. And you'll only see its value when you see your own wretched poverty. When you deep down inside of yourself and look at that mind and realize how empty and vain that it is, then will you finally see the true value of wisdom and then seek it the way she should be sought. I'll be 40 years old this December, Gary. I'm just young. I'm young, Anna. Remember when you was 40? Many, many moons ago, wasn't it?
We got the transition to church and we had a birthday party. We were here.
Be 40 years old this December. The thing I've learned about mankind is he's a hypocrite. I've learned that about men. And I'm not saying that to be mean. We're all hypocrites. Yeah, yeah. You know, Christ looked at the most religious people of his time and said, you blind hypocrites. Hypocrites. I've watched people do flip-flops in church. You have to understand, I've been in church since I was 9 years old, man. 31 years I've watched Christians. I've sat Methodist churches, Pentecostal churches. My grandpa used to tour in a bus. He had a quartet, man, and they'd go all over the place, all over West Virginia and Ohio, singing in churches. I've been to some weird churches. My wife grew up in a full gospel assembly, you know, Gethsemane House of Prayer, you know. I've seen all that stuff. I've watched people do flip-flops and throw their hands up and scream and pass out. I've watched Christians talk 31 years about healing, anointing oil. I've listened to them talking to them about sickness, the infirmities of this life, stress. When they ask questions, it's like, where did Cain get his wife? Who's coming back on the white horse? Who's the bride of Christ? I've seen them argue about water baptism. And even men as smart as Ruckman was in the Bible, Ruckman was way off on water baptism. I've watched people coming up to altars like this and beg for the gift of tongues. People treat ministers like doctors and therapists and CEOs and all this other stuff. They never treat them like the ministers of Christ. You know what Paul meant when he said, I'm a minister of Christ? He was ministering Jesus Christ to you. When he said in 2 Corinthians that we are ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit, for the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life, whose life you think that Spirit has given you? It's the life of Christ. He said, we're not like Moses who put a veil over his face. He said, but we all with open face are beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord are changed into that same image from glory to glory. Amen. You see, the ministration of the New Testament is the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. The ministry of the Old Testament was the letter. The letter revealed who you were. And it killed you. The ministration of the New Testament is to reveal who he is and to change you into that man. That's what a minister of Christ is. They are stewards of God's mysteries. I've been in church 31 years, and it's rare. I've had a handful of them. This church right here don't even compare to the church I pastored before. And I had some doozies in there, man. My deacon was a good one. Jerry Gerald, he was a good one. I showed him right division. The man sat and watched Les Feld look till the day he died. He said, preacher, most important thing you ever taught me was that Paul was our apostle. Amen? But I've been in church, man, and it's rare to find people, you know, people talk about everything in the world, but it's rare to find people that'll come up and be like, what does it mean to be under grace? What's the difference between grace and law? Christians, they never ask, you know, what does it mean to serve in newness of spirit? See, I read those verses through my 20s and all this, and I'd read a verse like that we should serve in newness of spirit, not in the oldness of the letter, and I'd be like, that's important. I didn't understand it, but I knew enough to know that this is how we now serve God. So what would I do? I'd applied my heart to understanding. Romans 8:14. You never get phone calls. Even people that message me on Facebook, man, they got some doozies sometimes, you know. Romans 8:14, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Yeah. What a verse. And in fact, as a young, ignorant man, I allowed that verse to cause me to doubt my salvation from time to time because I didn't understand it. Paul's talking about sonship and adult maturity. You go back under the law, you're a child. If you continue in the spirit, God's going to bring you into adult perfection. That's what Paul's talking about. You're going to go from childhood to sonship. Because God has not given us a spirit of bondage again to fear, but the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. Galatians 2:19, I threw the law dead to the law that I might live unto God. What a verse! I can live unto God, yeah, but not by the law. Then how? the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me.
Yeah.
There was a time I was about 26, 27 years old. I was working at Georgia Pacific. Mike Carpenter worked there down in Mount Hope. I'd spent weeks after weeks, man, battling sin, battling these thoughts. God, I want to be righteous. Show me how to be righteous. And I never wanted to go back under the law because I didn't want to be self-righteous, Gary. I wasn't a legalist. I knew better than to put myself back under the law. But I didn't understand, how can I, being a sinner under grace, live unto God? How can I serve God? Seemed like the harder I tried, the worse it got. I was walking up these stairs to this, called it the debarker cab at Georgia Pacific. I was walking up there to start my job. And as I was walking up the steps, I was praying about it, praying about it, praying about it. And all of a sudden, man, that verse just ripped in there. The life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. I didn't understand it. But I was like, there it is. That's how I live, in the flesh, right now. If you live after the flesh, ye shall what? Die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. And the Spirit is operating in us right now by the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. What's written on the pages of that book are detrimental to your life. Or not detrimental, they're important to your life. Not detrimental. They're important to your life. They're absolutely essential is the word I was looking for. The Spirit of God, you tell people all the time, God indwells us by the Spirit, the Spirit, the Spirit, the Spirit. You're like, where's he at? Show me the Spirit of God. To most people, the Spirit of God is this little thing that plopped into them at salvation, and now, you know, we're just all following the Spirit of God. We're going to let the Lord lead tonight. You've been in those services. We're just going to obey God. And 115 songs later, and you still ain't even got a Bible out. We're letting God lead. And then when you get done, you're like, it was such a good service tonight, we're not even going to preach. Right there is God's Spirit. You cannot have a spiritual service without this book, folks. Right there. The evidence of being filled with the Spirit is you do. Listen, I understand. These things right here are the production of people that were filled with the Spirit of God. I understand that. You wouldn't have Kneel at the Cross and at Calvary and all of those great hymns had somebody not first stuck their nose in the book and took some time to learn it. That's the Spirit of God right there. You can't separate them. Amen. Now, I understand that we've got the indwelling Spirit of God, but the way the Spirit of God fills us and works in us is through this book. Paul said, how did you get the Spirit? The works of the law or the hearing of faith? That's how you get the Spirit of God. That's how the Spirit of God ministers and works in us. All right. Look at 1 Corinthians 3. I'm going to close. Finish this next week. Where is wisdom found? I guess we'll have to answer that question next week. That wisdom's hidden in Christ. We're going to look at it in more detail. What does that mean? It's one thing to know it's hidden in Christ. You ain't going to find it down here. You're wasting your... Go home and Google it. Go home and ask Google, where's wisdom found? See if it's got the answer. Ask Siri. You think I'm kidding? If Google can't answer where the most principal thing in heaven and earth is found, why would you ask it anything? Amen, amen, amen. God not only told you what the most important thing was, he told you where it was hid. It's hid in the Lord Jesus Christ. You say, how do I access it? By faith. The just shall live by faith. Look at Proverbs or 1 Corinthians 3. Some of the most misused passages in the Bible. Verse 8, now he that planteth and he that watereth are one. And every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are laborers together with God. You're God's husbandry, you're God's building. Let me ask you something. If we're laborers together with God, if a pastor or a preacher or a minister today cannot tell you what the mystery of God's will is, how can that man be doing anything for God? Paul's going to come down here and tell you in chapter 4, verse 1, he said, let a man so account of us. You want to take proper inventory and stock of a man? It's not how many people he's got in his church. You want to take proper inventory of a man? It ain't how well he runs the church like a CEO. Paul said, if you want to take proper account of us as of the ministers of Christ. Is the man forming Christ in you or isn't he? And if he's not, then he's not a minister of Christ. He's a minister of a lot of things, but it ain't Christ. The New Testament ministry is we are building a body indwelt by the head of the body, the Lord Jesus Christ. But Gary, I wouldn't even know where to begin. That's what God's doing today. He's building a body for His Son to indwell through all the wisdom and knowledge of this New Testament He's given us. So excuse me, but I mean, that's a spiritual work. It has nothing to do with the carnal, fleshly things of this world. Have 1,500 people, man. If we had 1,500 people in this church and we all went up and stood before the Lord one day and Christ wasn't found to be in any of us, we wasted our time. Look at what he says. You're God's building. According to the grace of God which is given unto me as a what? Wise master builder. I have laid the foundation, another man buildeth thereon, but let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon, for other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now if any man build upon this foundation gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work, not works, his work, what? In this building. Now, the average person thinks that this chapter is about works and us going up to the judgment seat of Christ and our works being judged. And our bad works are going to be burned up, our good works are going to stand, and our good works are going to withstand the fire, and then we're going to receive reward because of the good things we've done. I say, I listen to all of it too, Gary. I've taught that. I've taught it. And I ain't taught it since I've been here. but I've taught it. Ruckman, I mean, I can bring Ruckman's commentary over. Ruckman's got a whole spiel on the gold being deity and how, you know, every time we put God first in our life, we're building gold and all this stuff. It's all about you. Who's the treasures of wisdom and knowledge hid in? Christ is plumb full of gold, silver, and precious stones. That's why the Father approved of him, gave him his own right hand. The gold, silver, and precious stones is Christ in you. The riches of the glory of the mystery of our fellowship to the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm going to prove it to you. Come to Proverbs 24. What was Paul talking about all through 1 Corinthians? Were the Corinthians divided? You know why they were divided? Would the mind of Christ divide us? What would the mind of Christ do? It unifies, right? One mind, one judgment. So listen, Paul didn't have to go in there and figure out where the fight started. He didn't have to go in there and be like, well, you know, what's going on here? Let's get to the root of the problem. Paul knew the root of the problem. As soon as he found out, all they had to do was come to Paul and say, look, that church's got some contention in it. He's like, okay, I know how to address it. He didn't care who's right, who's wrong. He just wrote a letter and he said, look here, We preach Christ to you crucified, and through that cross, God destroyed the wisdom of the world. Why are you still walking after the wisdom of the world? Because he knew the wisdom of the world was the root of the problem. That's how he addresses it. And then he comes down there into chapter 2 and he said, we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom, which God ordained before the world unto our glory. And he's telling them how to grow up and to come into this perfection of this hidden wisdom of God. How is it that Paul was talking about wisdom and doctrine for 3 chapters, and then we get into chapter 3 and we think all of a sudden now he's done switched to our works? He's building something there. Look at Proverbs 24 and 3, and I'm done. Through wisdom is a house what? There it is. Did Paul say that God gave him grace as a wise master builder? Paul was building this house through the wisdom that God had given him. And he said, through that wisdom I've laid the foundation, and that foundation was Jesus Christ. That therefore, now if you're going to be built, you have to be built upon Paul's foundation. Not Moses's, not Peter's. Look, verse 3, by understanding it is what? How are you going to be established upon the foundation? Paul laid the foundation through wisdom, and it is only by understanding that you can be established upon that foundation. And so what does that mean? You're going to have to understand what Paul wrote. I know it's tough sometimes, folks. Romans 6, 3, he that is dead is freed from sin. You think I understood that passage my whole life? I didn't. I'd read it, Gary, and be like, well, I ain't freed from sin. Paul's not talking about your experience. He's talking about who you are in Christ. Are you crucified with him or not? And if you are, you're freed from sin, whether you feel like it or not. And it's not until you believe that doctrine that that's going to become a reality in your life. Paul said, you were the servants of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered unto you. And it was through obedience to the doctrine of being dead and freed from sin that they became free from sin in their life and in their walk. Sin no longer reigned in them. Because they learned who they were in Christ. And by learning who they were in Christ, Christ was beginning to indwell them. Remember when Paul said that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith? Christ is literally dwelling in us through what God gave us in this book. Read verse 4. This is a good one. You want to know what the gold, silver, and precious stones are? By knowledge shall the chambers be filled with all precious and pleasant riches. By wisdom a house is built. Through understanding it is established. And if you want to beautify the chambers of that building, it comes through knowledge. We ain't worried about this thing right here. This thing right here, man, give it another 20 years. Teeth will be falling out. Lungs are going to be struggling to breathe. Bones are going to be falling, starting to hurt and ache. Amen. I'm not worried about this thing right here. Not worried about it. I'm worried about that inner man. Paul said, be renewed in the spirit of your mind and put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. That same God who created Adam in his own image and breathed in his nostrils the breath of life is now, through the word of God working in us and renewing our mind, is recreating us into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Through the ministry of this book. Yep. When I stand before God, I don't know how they miss it. We can sit here and debate it hours upon hours. How did Oliver Green and How does Gipp, how do them guys miss 1 Corinthians chapter 3? I know Gipp's been through the book of Proverbs 350 times. He never made the connection of Proverbs 24 and 1 Corinthians 3. That stuff baffles me. We're set and told this whole time, get out there and get busy for God. The judgment seat of Christ is coming. Right? And we put this book up and like, we got to go get busy for God. And it's the knowledge of this book that fills your chambers with riches and gold and silver and precious stones. Paul said, we preach Christ, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom that we may present every man perfect in Christ. What's getting you ready to be presented to God? The teaching of Christ in all wisdom. That's what's getting you ready. Amen. And I long, you know, Paul said that we're going to give, that we're going to receive for the things done, not in our body. He didn't say that. He said we're all going to receive the things done in His body. It's Christ's body. Yeah. Amen. And I truly believe what the way the judgment seat of Christ is going to go, we're going to stand there. And when you have to, when you read Romans 8:18, Paul had just said we are joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with Him. Right? That I may know Him, the power of His resurrection, the fellowship of His sufferings. Didn't He say that? And so when you're reading Romans 8, when He says the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us, Paul is talking, that whole chapter is about spiritual maturity. The glory revealed in you. What is your glory? What is your hope of glory? It's Christ in you. You see? The glory that's going to be revealed in us is Christ. That ministration of glory is 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Now, once you believe you're in Christ, you're sealed in Christ, folks. But maturity's a whole different ballgame. Yeah. Amen? Some people are going to suffer loss. They're going to stand before Christ, and all that's going to be found in them is wood, hay, and stubble. Tongues, baptisms, holy days, seventh day, all this stuff. Christmas and Easter. Wish me a Merry Christmas, you know. All that stuff. Politics. And then some are going to stand there, man, and that glory of Christ is going to come ripping out of them. And most of them spent their life down here being criticized, ridiculed, despised, hated, no big church. And they're going to stand before Christ, man, and that's what's going to be revealed in them. Right there. While everybody else is playing games. Amen. The judgment seat of Christ is a judgment of the measure of the fullness of Christ. We'll look at some of this next week in Ephesians 4. Unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. And so Ephesians is all about that fullness of Christ. Next week we're going to pick up on where we find wisdom. It's hidden Christ. How we access it by faith in the Word of God. And then how that Word of God works in us to give unto you all these riches of glory and all this wisdom and knowledge of Christ in us. And that's going to be the standard at the judgment seat of Christ. Amen. All right, let's pray. Father, we do thank You. God, I thank You just 40 years, God, and just how much this Bible can take an old fool like me and give him understanding into great things. God, if You took this Bible out of the world, man would understand anything that You've freely given us in this book, God. We wouldn't know about our Savior dying for us. We wouldn't know about this great privilege of being a member of His body. We wouldn't understand the mystery of Your will in filling us with all the knowledge and wisdom of Your Son to remold us into His image. God, I thank You for this book. I thank You for little churches like this, Father, that still emphasize the important thing. I thank You for Judy and Gary and Jessica and Doris and Corin and John Loudon and Carly. I thank You for all of them, God. Stephen and just everybody here this morning. And Father, I just thank You for people like this that'll come into buildings like this, Father, not looking for the bells and whistles, but just looking for a minister that is going to faithfully minister the truth of Your word to them. Father, we know it is the principal thing. It is the thing that You magnified above all Your name. And I just ask, God, that You would always help us to stand for this book. We pray for Fairmont, God. We pray, Lord, that you would allow the light, Father, as we continue to grow and mature into these things. Father, we pray that this would be a church, Lord, not of programs and operations and all this stuff, Father, but we will be a church, God, in which the glory of Christ truly shines out of for the world to see. And God, I ask that you keep us safe. Be with Brother Bill again, Lord. Just bless him, God, and we just pray for him. We pray that you would strengthen him. And we just ask all these things in the lovely and precious name of Jesus Christ, our great God and Savior. Amen.